Hello, I'm John McGee. I'm the Executive Director of Educational Technology Services at the University of North Alabama. Welcome to our presentation on utilizing curriculum mapping to assess campus OER adoption.
And I am Jennifer Pate. I am the Open Education Resources and Scholarly Communications Librarian at Collier Library on the campus of the University of North Alabama.
And I'm Rachell Berry. I was the graduate assistant for Jen and John at the University of North Alabama in the MA program in Rhetoric and Technical Communication. I'm now in the PhD program at the University of Memphis in the Writing, Rhetoric, and Technical Communication department.
So to begin with, I just want to give you a brief overview of our presentation. So we're going to start with a little bit about OER at UNA, how we started the process. Overview of curriculum mapping, a little bit about our goals for that OER adoption, the stages of the curriculum mapping process, our conclusions, and then our references. So the first thing that happened at UNA is part of our strategic plan. There was an aspirational goal defined to have a 50% adoption of OER in all programs. And what resulted from that was our provost charged Educational Technology Services and Collier Library with implementing an OER initiative at UNA. That resulted with Collier Library and Educational Technology Services working to form an OER working group through our shared governance process to pull in primarily Jennifer Pate and myself as sort of the primary movers in the group, but then to also pull in supportive faculty and staff that you know might be helpful with our OER implementation, our SGA representation, and then ask us to move forward with trying to encourage OER adoption at UNA. So the, one of the primary things that has resulted from that is that we created a grant program for faculty to get them to adopt, adapt, or implement OER in their courses. So far, that's gotten approximately 20 faculty. And has caused a savings of about $300,000, so approaching $300,000 for students. Another couple of things that have come out of that have been helpful are we had our SGA representatives draft a resolution in support of OER at UNA. And as part of our online course design processes, we now have our librarians in that process meet with faculty to encourage adoption of OER and use of library resources. And obviously the other thing that came from that is the move for this curriculum mapping process.
And now I'm gonna talk about sort of the genesis of this project. So when we think about curriculum mapping, why curriculum mapping with OER? Curriculum mapping is something that has been used in libraries for quite some time. Charbooth and Brian Matthews have a really great article about curriculum mapping. Charbooth has been a huge proponent of curriculum mapping for years. And what we've done at Collier in the past was we mapped the curriculum so that we could find places within the curriculum where there were research or writing components where we could offer our services as librarians, that we could go to those instructors or to those programs and say, here's how we can support the research needs of your students or the writing students, the writing needs of your students. And so recently, UNA has added quite a few minors, a couple of majors, and more graduate programming, including our first doctoral programs. And so we decided it was time that we updated our curriculum maps here at the library. And when we were talking about updating the curriculum maps, this really kind of stood out to me that, you know, it is a way to see how the learner is negotiating what they're engaging with in their learning experience or their degree path. And I thought, we need to use curriculum mapping to see what curriculum material students are having to engage with. What are the cost of those materials? How many books are required for certain courses or certain majors? So that's kind of what sparked the idea for this project. So our goals for this project, we had quite a few goals. One, like John mentioned, we have this by 2024 aspirational goal that 50% of our academic programs on this campus or online will include some form of OER. So we wanted to see where we are at with that. We also wanted to be able to mark those courses in our catalog. One of the things that has come out of all of the OER work that we've done is that we have recognized that there is a real need for students as informed consumers to know how much a course is going to cost them in curriculum materials. So we know of the OER, the 20 or so instructors with the 25 or so classes that have gone through our stipend or grant program, but we didn't know about that hidden OER. What other instructors are using OER that we don't know about that we need to know about so that we can mark those courses? And here at UNA, we have OER and textbook affordability initiatives. So it all can be funded through the grant program. It's all about reducing costs for our students. So if your curriculum materials cost less than $50, I like to tell my faculty $49.99 or less, you can have your course marked in Banner as a low cost or no cost course. And it's really important for our students that they are able to visualize that information. So how do we find this? Curriculum mapping and mapping book orders. So we wanted to make sure that we could find this material, but we could also find the programs that weren't really using OER so that we can focus some outreach efforts on those areas to encourage them to apply for grants, to show them what material is available in those fields that they could potentially switch to. And that's one of the great outcomes of this project is that as we are going through these book lists that Rachell has compiled for us, we are able to connect with those departments. And I've already got two meetings on my calendar in the next month to go talk to people about moving to OER. And another really great outcome that we're starting to look at now is finding those programs that have a lot of OER use and might be, potentially, we might be able to move them to a Z degree, where if somebody is in that major, they can get through that major with zero textbook costs. So those are really the overall goals of this program. And I do want to mention, and Rachell will talk about this later in the presentation, is that while we were doing all of this work, while we were compiling all of this stuff over the past year, there was somebody in the Spark OER Leadership Program who was working on a similar project that as we were reaching sort of like the conclusion of the big mapping portion of our project, the capstone projects came out from the Spark Leadership Program, and it was for Viva, which is in Virginia. It's a consortium, and such great information in there that we will try to incorporate the next time we go through to update our curriculum maps. So with that said, I am going to turn it over to Rachell.
Thank you, Jen. So let's take a look at the stages of the curriculum mapping project and our approach to the creation of the curriculum maps. So we knew we wanted two sets of data, mapped book lists and the courses. So we have our spreadsheets that list the course, the professor, and any other relevant info, which we broke down by subject and then had them all filed alphabetically to make it easy for a librarian to peruse. So once we had that set of data, we gathered the book orders themselves, and this involved reaching out to both instructors and the library. These two steps from start to finish took me about 6 months, starting in the spring. And of course, it wasn't all just entering the data and making the spreadsheets the entire time. You spend a lot of time going back and forth, trying to hunt this data down, crunching it through the spreadsheets, looking and seeing where you still have holes, and then reaching back out to your instructors or to the bookstore to see what you might have missed for text. So while we're creating these spreadsheets, we're keeping in mind that we're going to want to cross-reference these so that we can crosswalk the data from the two sets of spreadsheets for the tracking of OER in our courses. So you don't have to think of this as only a linear process. Part of this is we're trying to see what students see. They're not always navigating this linearly either. But we know we want to have a visualization of our courses and our books to cross-reference. So again, you're going to find your course descriptions to make your first set of spreadsheets. These descriptions I used are course catalog. Some might want to use a syllabi. Then you create the spreadsheets of all the offered courses, again, by department. And that second set is the book orders collected, that set of spreadsheets, and then those will be merged. Here's a great example. You can see I've got the course description there. The descriptions are important to include because they help us see what the students see. And they can be used to determine a course unit's OER suitability, or if it's maybe not a suitable course and we want to focus on another subject for now. Once the book orders are collected, the new spreadsheets are created, which will have those course numbers, not the description. And then the books or text use. So here we go. Here's one that Jen has started filling out. I filled out the book section. Jen was able to look at bookstore cost. So one great thing about this is that when we know the bookstore cost per text that we're going to be used, we can, if it's under that $49.99 threshold that Jen mentioned, then we can mark that as part of the textbook affordability initiative so that we're still having some cost affordability for our students, even if it's not explicitly an OER course. We're still going to track that in these spreadsheets. So this larger example shows us where you're going to see a lot of hidden OER once you have these two data sets together and you start cross-referencing them, or at least that's what we happily found at our institution. So this is a criminal justice book list. All of these that are highlighted are hidden OER where the professor or instructor was already using elements of OER, but did not go through our program or through our working group. So we found this out once we had all our data together and once we could look at the books. And then Jen can track when she's reached out to these professors, when she could reach out to them again. And this also gives us a way to show students that they might have a choice. So in criminal justice, you might have several instructors teaching the same course unit. Maybe three of them use required texts that are not going to be OER, but one of them does have an OER element. So there's still student choice and affordability options there. And we're able to see all that once we have the curriculum maps together, once we have our data sheets side by side and we start consolidating all that. So there are some other things you can do along the course of this process that I took information from VIVA, the Virginia Virtual Library, their curriculum mapping course kit. They did things a little differently for me. So for example, they used their syllabi for each courses instead of just looking it up in the registration portal or in the course catalog. They actually reached out to the instructors and asked, can you send me your syllabus? And were able to get the description and the probably required text that way. They offer worksheets on VIVA's website. We have the link to that in our references slide if you want to look at that later. There's also templates for emailing instructors. You could email the registrar using one of their templates if you like. A few more tips that they had for us, that when you're contacting instructors, you might feel more comfortable starting in subject areas with which you already have some familiarity. Of course, maybe someone you already know as an instructor on campus. Then you can branch out as you work more with OER and become more comfortable talking about it and reaching out to people. You may even find that once you start speaking with the people you already know or subjects you're familiar with, that interest develops. They realize that this is all going to be a interrelated project of different groups working together. And so that legitimizes it a little, and people start reaching out, offering information, or wanting to know more about what we're doing here. So all of this is basically, I tried to keep in mind something that Viva said, more info equals more data. So if we know the topics, even just the learning objectives, learning outcomes, is the course accessible? What kind of accessibility accommodations do they have in this course? All of that is going to be valuable information that plays into not only whether the course can use OER, but what kinds of OER materials you're going to want to find, work with, or hunt down for these courses and these instructors. Some of our conclusions, now that we're coming toward the end and we're starting to synthesize our data. Well, we found that the process of creating curriculum maps for this project helped reduce the complexity for analyzing student degree completion paths. That's something that our librarian can see now and can share with students. It's something that anyone working on these OER curriculum maps is going to be able to see. Those data sheets and maps are reusable. I wanted to make everything I had in them very clear so that anyone coming behind me could keep on mapping, even coming up with their own project ideas, building on what we have, and not ever having to start back over. And because, like I said, it took about 6 months to track all this down. So you want to make sure that it's something that makes sense to someone other than just yourself when you're building them. And having all this, again, increased the visibility of OER on campus. The use, where it's used, when it's used, is clear to students and faculty alike. We can also quickly assess areas for OER targeting and see which courses are cross-listed, is something you're also going to like about this. It's just a bonus that if faculty can see everywhere that OER is being used and get an idea of what those alternatives look like. So you can check our reference slide to see which papers we referenced here and some info about Viva. There's a link there if you want to check out their course mapping companion kit and all of those templates I mentioned. Very helpful, and we hope to draw from some of that going forward. Thank you so much. So if you have any questions, feel free to reach out to us at our email. We also have a website on our institutional website that talks a little bit about our projects as a group, as well as the grant process for our instructors at our institution. We have a Facebook page, Instagram, and if you look on Twitter, you may find us there as well.